was an opportunity. Oh no, actually, I want to know how did they meet and how did they fall in love and what were the obstacles to the relationship and all this stuff. So that's what interested me. That I could meet them when they met, introduce them to you when they meet each other.
So you met both of them.
Well, no, Laurel had passed away. Yeah, by the time that I got involved, she died in 2006, and got involved around 2009. But in a way, I did. So I met Stacy, played by Ellen Page. I certainly met Dane, played by Michael Shannon. I met Stephen Goldstein, who's played by Stephen Carell. And more than met them. I mean, I spent significant time with them, and then the cast eventually spent significant time with them as well, and became rather attached to Dane and Stacy, particularly. But also because the documentary, as I'm sure all of you know, a documentary may only be 25 minutes by the time it's released to the audience, but that documentarian has probably shot, you know, tens if not hundreds of hours of footage. So there was a lot of footage of Laurel that didn't make it into the final documentary. So I read all those transcripts. So in a way, I did meet Laurel. She was alive to me, so I could hear her voice.
What was Stacy's reaction to seeing the finished film, this film?
Well, you know, that was the thing that I was most concerned about, you know, and so I saw Stacy. We were at the Toronto Film Festival, and I hadn't seen Stacy for a couple of years, and I walked into the hotel lobby, and when she was there, I said, hey, you gave her a big hug, and then I realized I hadn't heard if she'd seen the film or not. I said, oh, have you seen it? She said, yes. I thought, oh, no. And she said, no, it's great, it's great. And she said, you know, I really... it's hard for her, she said, to watch somebody pretend to be her. As I imagine, it would just be weird, right? I mean, for any of us. And Stacy's bigger than Ellen. With that thing where Stacy changes the tires, it actually makes a little bit more sense when you see the real Stacy, because she can lift those tires. She's a big girl. And but she said it was a little weird, but she said Julianne, she said it was very painful for her because Julianne just had Laurel. She could sort of embodied Laurel in a way, and that was a very odd thing for her to watch Laurel brought back to life.
Do you think there's a stigma with the movie studios against gay-themed movies? Well, I know that you call this a love story. I do too. It should be marketed as a love story.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not. It's a love story.
Yes,
it's not
right.
About anything else.
Yeah.
Do you think that that is a problem beyond a certain budget? If people perceive it as a gay themed.
Well, you know, that's it. I mean, that's.
I don't want to be unfair.
No, no. There's a long. And by the way, we should be very grateful to our producers and to the financiers. And you know, there's a long answer to that. I'll try to give the short version of the long answer, which is that it's hard to get adult dramas made now as feature films. I happen to be working right now on cable television. I don't know, are any of you fans of Homeland? Okay, I'm on Homeland. So tonight's a really good episode, by the way. And I wrote next week's episode, episode 4, and a few weeks from now, episode 8. And I'm supposed to be home right now writing episode 12, but don't tell my boss that I'm here. Cable television has become the place where adult dramas are taking place. So it's really hard to get people to the movie theaters to pay 12 bucks, 15 bucks a ticket, do the babysitter, drive them, you know, all that stuff, when there's so much great television. You know, we could just go on and on, great shows. So that's this first stumbling block. Second, and I just have to say it, anything with a woman lead instead of a male lead is gonna be harder. And it's just harder. They're harder to sell, they're harder to get made. And that's just a fact. So then you make them lesbians. Yes, of course, it's tough. But it's not, I have to say, I think there's some things about the movie that I wish were different. And my producers erred on the side of being too progressive in a way. What happened is that Laurel and Stacy are not as sort of perfect as they are in the movie. Mm. And that's why I thought it'd be great to kind of write them. I'll give you one example. The real Laurel, even after her diagnosis of lung cancer, would not stop smoking. She couldn't. And you know, it was a huge conflict between she and Stacy. You know, Laurel would reach for the cigarette, and it even got to the point when the cancer got in her brain and she was a little off, Stacy would let her hold it, but pretend to light the cigarette, but she'd hold the flame out here. And Laurel thought she was smoking. And I thought, God, that's fantastic. What a great detail. And my producer said, oh, no, you know, we don't want to blame the victim, which is silly. If you smoke cigarettes for 30 years and you get lung cancer, you probably had something to do with getting lung cancer. It is related. You know, it's just, to me, it was just an interesting, moving human detail. Mm-hmm. About somebody, you know, that, you know, that, but that's where they erred. They made them a little too clean, I think. And some of the critics are saying that about the film.
I think a movie, when it's a little more raw, it's easier for me to embrace, yeah, for some reason.
Yeah.
Do you think movies have the potential to actually change opinions by creating empathy for characters that are marginal? In the world, you know, the movies saturate the world with stories. Can they change opinions?
Certainly. I mean, I'm very lucky. One of the most significant things in my professional life is a movie called Philadelphia that I wrote about 20 years ago. And that movie, at the time of the AIDS crisis, and it was a huge success. I have been for 20 years been approached by people who have said to me things like, just amazing things. Like, somebody told me recently that they're beginning to transition. They found their courage to transition from one gender to the other because they watched Philadelphia, which I didn't quite get because I don't quite know what Philadelphia has to do with that. But they were from a small town and they felt that that movie had sort of encouraged them. And I've had for 20 years stories about how that movie particularly affected
people. Sure.
And I know that I've been affected by movies. So, yes, I do believe movies have an effect on the culture.
You wrote an incredible book, a memoir. Is that
going to
be
Blue
a movie?
Black Nights.
Blue Days, Black Nights. very confessional.
We're reissuing in April, so I encourage you to wait till then to get it. There's going to be a new chapter at the end.
Is that?
It's a memoir.
On the road to becoming a movie?
It's not a memoir like I was born and blah, 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 blah. It's about 1 year of my life. I mean, I'm not that old. I should be writing my memoirs yet. So, about...
Well, Justin Bieber has written his first memoir.
Yeah, well, he's an old soul, you know? About 18 years ago, 18 or 19 years ago, I fell in love with somebody, and it ended, and he was the most amazing character. Even when I was with him, I thought, oh, I'm going to write a book about this guy. However this ends, because he was just a fabulously bizarre, hilarious, witty, he was a hustler is what he was, but he was an incredible character, and I thought I'm going to write about him, and our relationship ended tragically with his tragic death. That's what I wrote about, so it's a darker, it's raw, yeah, because it's all out there. I thought, you know, I'm gonna put it all out there. You know, every drug I did, every drink I drank, however you say that. And it's also a love story.
So
it's gonna be a movie. I don't want to relive it.
You're not interested in doing it or writing it.
It's been 20 years. I've been sober for many years. I love that people read it, and people read it and love it and get passionate about it. And I think that's where it belongs.
Do you remember the first movie you saw?
The first movie I saw?
The first movie you saw in a theater.
In a theater?
Yeah, the big screen where you sat as a kid.
God,
did that impress you at all?
I don't remember. I tell you where I saw movies that impressed me. I saw, like a lot of people my age, I saw them on TV, you know? So I'd be like, you know, I'd be watching like some Joan Crawford melodrama. Like, my mother come home like, what are you watching those girls movies for? You know, like, ooh, because she's so great, she's fabulous, she's so powerful, all the men like are afraid of her, it's fantastic. You know, I didn't say any of those things, of course. I like turn it off and say, oh, I was just looking for something else. I remember being really caught up by the classic Hollywood movies, you know, with mostly you know, it's with mostly those strong, powerful gay, those strong, powerful women.
Melodramas, powerful.
Melodramas. I love melodrama. I'm gay. I can't assume it.
Do you remember the first thing you wrote for money? You got paid to write?
Wow. These are good questions, Rob. You're good. Well, I don't know, did we get paid on the high school newspaper? You know, I've been writing, you know, I remember as early as sixth grade, I was writing plays that we would do. I don't know if I'm sure I didn't get paid. But the thing in writing for me, it is so essential, and it's something that I do every day. And, you know, so, you know, I meet people who say to me, oh, I have a great idea for a movie. And I say, you know, talk to me in 20 years. You know, because what I do, the reason I have the career that I have is because I get up every day at 5 a.m. and I write, and I sell, and I'm out there, and I'm, you know, pitching, and not, you know, it's a commitment to a life. It's not about having a few ideas in your head. So I made the commitment to the life a long time ago, actually.
Would you comment a little bit about your private writing habits besides getting up in the morning?
I wonder where you're going with that. I know it's a small, intimate group, and I don't know how far we want to go.
Well, I know some writers can only write in pencil on a yellow legal tablet. I know some can only dictate a story or feel comfortable.
Rob, I work in television. We have to churn those scripts out. My boss is like, I'll see your pages tomorrow. No, I don't have time for longhand. You know, it's this, you know, this, no, we don't have time. You know, plus, I love writing on a computer. Now, what I do sometimes is I switch it up just to get to, but you know, I don't have to do that anymore. I have to say, I've been doing this for 35 years, and I can basically write a script with my eyes closed, I guess, if that's possible. But it's something that is very natural to me now, so I don't need any kind of. If I was forced to write with pen and a pad, I would.
You're capable of writing with a pad.
I open my computer on the airplane, which I did this morning. I open my computer in a hotel lobby. I open my computer at Starbucks. I can just churn it out. That's what I do.
Were you on the set?
Sorry, it makes writing sound so unromantic, but at a certain point it is.
Were you on the set during production?
Not much, no.
Were you in a shot? In this movie?
I wasn't. I didn't make it into this one. I was busy, you know, I was working on television then, and you know, in television your presence is required in the room. So I wasn't able to be on the set.
Is this the movie that you had in your head pretty much? When you wrote it, and
all movies change, you know, they change, and it's a little bit. That's why actually I love television, because in television the writer has artistic authority. You know, so it's so on the set of Homeland, on my episode, I represent my boss, who's the showrunner and creator, and the director. When the director directs the actors, and he directs them, and he says cut. And then he turns to me, the writer producer, and says, "Do we have it, Ron?" And I say, "Dan, you do." I say, "Yeah," or I say, "Nope, you need another take." So that's the difference between working in feature films, where I wasn't even on the set, and on Homeland, they couldn't start the day if I wasn't on the set. That's the difference. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, I do. If you weren't a writer, what do you think you'd be?
Wow, it's so essential to me that I can't imagine. You won't believe this having read my book, but actually I was going to be a minister. That was before I discovered I kind of just like the way the guys looked in the priest collar and stuff. You know, so it was like, am I drawn to God or like am I drawn to like the Father? So I sorted those things out and ended up writing.
I love the pastor in the movie.
Yeah,
the
that's real. Yeah,
statement.
He's real.
I mean, that was kind of that was a central factor in this story. The pastor saying that to me.
Well, you know, I'm actually a practicing Christian, which a lot of people find an odd combination with a progressive gay activist, and which to me is not at all, because real Christianity is about making the world a better place and having love and compassion for others.
Do unto others.
Exactly.
Golden rule.
There you go.
Okay, let's open up to some questions.
Are
Hi.
I'm Kay Shackleton.
Hey, Kay. It was so nice to talk to you the other day.
Yes. I have a question about Showtime. You know, I hear a lot of people talk about HBO and how wonderful it is to work with them, but I've never talked to anybody that works for Showtime. And I was wondering if the creative process is good there, as I hear about Showtime.
I wrote a movie for them in 2003 called Soldier's Girl, which won a lot of awards, and I had a fantastic time. I made a pilot for them. I've written 4 pilots for them, and I've done 2 shows for them, Ray Donovan and Homeland. They're my family, and they're great.
That's wonderful
to
hear.
They're fantastic.
Great, thank you.
You know, they just say, I mean, they give you notes on the script, and you say, and they're like, oh, try your best. No, they're really great. They really support and love artists.
That's wonderful to hear.
Yes.
When you write for these shows, do you have the idea and you pitch it to them, or do they say, we have this idea, give us a script?
Do you hear the question back there?
Repeat the question.
Yes, okay, sorry, I should have done that the first time. When you say for the shows, you mean for the films or for a television show mostly?
Yeah.
So do I have the ideas or are they given to me? So I pitch pilots. I have written pilots. Only one got made, but it didn't get turned into a show. That's a lot of, that would come from me. But when I was hired to come on to Homeland, what we do at the beginning of each season, like we did last January for season 5, you know, there are 7 of us in a room all day. Starting in January, we just started airing 2 weeks ago. So, and we debate, discuss, and wrestle with ideas together as a group. And we have what's called the showrunner, who's like the head writer. Remember Rob Petrie on the Dick Van Dyke Show? So the showrunner is usually the person often who created the show, not always, but often. And so in the end, the showrunner says, we're doing that idea, not that idea, that idea, not that idea. You know, so it's a group process, but then one person sort of makes the ultimate decisions. That's a good question.
This was such an emotional film. It was so powerful. I was moved so many times by the acts of bravery and kindness.
Oh, thank you.
I'm wondering, when you're constructing the screenplay, do those, and you've been doing it so long, but do those come naturally to you in the flow? Do you work where those happen? Did it just fit into the natural, the reality of their lives and how it all worked out?
Well, you know, I do a lot of research, and so I find, you know, what I'm interested in is both the darkness and the light. I mean, this film emphasizes, I think, maybe a little bit more of the light. My script had more conflict in it. The women were not as bound to each other at the time of her diagnosis, which I thought was interesting. You know, and then through the course of the fight and the diagnosis, their love deepened. My colleagues felt they should fall deeply in love with each other and then the bad things should happen. We had long arguments about that, and I lost. So I love drama. So drama is the high and the low. You know, so that's what I go for. I don't try to bring a moral thing, like I'm going to write inspiring moments so other people go out in the world and do good things. I'm going to put that inspiring moment in the scene. I don't write that at all. It's like, what's a good scene? What's a good argument for them to have? And then what's a great moment where they realize, oh, you know what, I kind of love you. So that's what I go for.
People talk about the 50s as the golden age of television. In my way of thinking, and I want to ask your opinion about this too, I think there was a second golden age when Brandon Tartikoff took over programming at NBC, and he allowed shows like L.A. Law and Hill Street Blues and Miami Vice. He brought some wonderful things to broadcast TV. And now with HBO and Showtime, Tony Soprano and 6 Feet Under and Homeland and all the great shows that are out there, do you think that we're in a third golden age of television? Is this just a great time to write for television?
It's an extraordinary time. I hadn't heard it was the third, but it's interesting how different people will trace it. A lot of people do trace intelligent adult drama on television to Hill Street Blues, which I was obsessed with. You know, then the cable revolution was definitely with The Sopranos. And it is a fantastic time to be in television. And the people that I get to talk to, I mean, you know, we on Homeland especially, we gotta be sharp. You walk in and my boss says, did you read these 5 articles in the New York Times? Did you see what Assad said in a 60 Minutes interview? Like, you gotta like know the world, you know? And that's, a lot of television now is getting at that level. So it's a fantastic time to be a TV writer.
Do you have one more, if I can, since I've got the mic anyway. Do you have a preference? Obviously, the money is not going to be the same in television as in motion pictures, but it's long been
said. I didn't get paid a lot for this, by the way, but that's okay. this is a low-budget film, but...
Sure, sure. I've heard many, many TV writers say that in TV, the writer is king, as opposed to in film, the director
there
is king.
As
what do you prefer, film or television?
Oh, television. There's just no question. For many reasons. A, because the writer's the king. It's my set. I make the final decision. But also, we get 12... In Homeland, we make 12 hours of drama in... Like, we shoot it in 6 months or 7 months. That's 6 feature films. And our budgets are around... Well, I can't tell you what they are. But they're like good small movies. We make huge... And if you kind of screw up something in an episode... Okay, how about the next episode? Fix that. You know, let's address that character, you know, her illness or something. Let's do it a little differently. So it's fantastic. It's like it never stops. You can always get better. You know, I would start this movie all over if I could. I would start all over, which I feel that about almost every movie that I get. You know, that's just who I am. I would start this all over. You know, now that I've seen, oh, okay, I know what people like, don't like, blah, blah, okay, let's start over. You can't do it in feature films. In television, it's like, okay, Homeland, season 3 was the dud, right? People hated season 3, and they came back with season 4, which knocked it out of the park. So you can do that. It's great.
Do you get hate mail for anything that is, you know, marginal characters that are reviled by some? No, I'm not about Homeland, but about gender, homosexual issues. Philadelphia, has anyone... Do you get anything like that? I'm always curious about that.
No.
Do you get it on Homeland?
Well, did you just hear about, we just had a big controversy this week, did you hear?
About the graffiti?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, wow.
We should just tell everybody, we should be talking about Freeheld, not Homeland, but it was kind of fun. We recreated a Lebanese, a refugee camp in Lebanon in the middle of Berlin, which is no easy feat, by the way. And we hired, being progressive people that we are, we hired genuine Arabic graffiti artists to supply the Arabic graffiti. Of course, nobody who reads Arabic checked what they were writing, and they wrote, Homeland is racist.
and what was the other one? Homeland's a watermelon, or they wrote watermelon, and that's a disparaging term
But my boss, to his credit, and there is meeting with somebody next week. One of the people who's quoted in the New York Times is saying it's the most racist show on television, and he's meeting with her next week. You know, that's who he is, and you know, we embrace it. You know, we gave these artists a platform. We didn't mean to. We thought it was great.
It's not bad publicity. Not really.
It's not really bad publicity. No.
Is there a story you're chasing that you'd like to write?
Oh yeah.
That you can talk about? This is a small group, no one's gonna...
Well, they, you know, I've already written a couple of them, so I've been desperate to do the story about Rock Hudson and his agent, a guy named Henry Wilson, who, fabulous. They were two gay men in the 50s who ruled Hollywood, and Henry Wilson was as ruthless as Tony Soprano in protecting his star, Rock. So I'm desperate to do that story. The Booths, Edwin and John Wilkes Booth, that relationship is fascinating, and it's America's great drama. And
he was great at naming his stars, wasn't he?
What do you mean?
Rock and Tab and...
Henry Wilson did.
He was good at that.
Yeah. He tried to name them all Troy Donahue. Like, everyone, like, Troy Donahue was like the fifth one, the real one. Like, it stuck. It's like, Rock was like Troy Donahue for like 5 minutes. Like, no, it doesn't quite fit. Well...
I have another question. There's so much similarity between Philadelphia and Freeheld. You know, you've got a conflict, somebody trying to get something, you know, that they feel is that they deserved. and then you've got somebody that's dying in the midst of that. I thought that Philadelphia explored the personal dire stress of that a little bit better than in this film. And I'm wondering, did you have more say on the set of Philadelphia?
I don't know exactly. I can't sort of answer to the exploring the dire stress because I don't know what you mean.
Well, like scenes from the freedom Tom Hanks was given in the scenes when he's in his home and the opera is going.
You know, I just think the difference between Philadelphia and Freeheld is A, it was a different time, and this is a young director making a very low budget. This has big stars in it, but this is actually a very low budget film. And Philadelphia was a medium budget film made by Jonathan Demme, who just won 5 Academy Awards for directing Silence of the Lambs, who was at that point a master director. And Jonathan and I worked on, and yeah, I had more input.
Yes,
the truth is
that's
that, that's your end. That Jonathan, at that point in his career, could do anything that he wanted to do, and we had the backing. And by the way, we never had to fight people for Philadelphia. The studio who made it was a different time, and the two guys who ran TriStar Pictures felt that they had a moral imperative to make Philadelphia. So when people say to me, "Oh, you must have had to convince those horrible studio executives," like, no, we didn't have to convince them at all. They were so anxious to embrace that movie. So. And Jonathan Demme and I are in Philadelphia, basically. The two guy, like the gay guy and the straight guy, that's what Jonathan and I did for 2 years. We just argued with each other. And what means to be gay, what means to be straight, and then we put that relationship in. So I am in much more Philadelphia.
That's interesting.
And we've been up here a long time.
Can you share what the budget was on this?
You know, I probably shouldn't. I don't think it's appropriate, but it's small.
Like $5 million, $10 million?
Well, that's sharing.
Okay. Well, you can kind of go.
It's under 10.
Oh. I have anyone else?
Well, you all been great. I feel like we've held you captive for so long.
I have a quote to leave with you.
Yes.
It's my quote. Next to sustenance, human beings crave narrative. You can use that. You don't even have to attribute it to me.
I agree with it completely.
Thank you for this glorious.